This is the, John is very carefully avoiding being involved in this, but...
there's no chair now.
No, no. This is John's idea is a little panel so we can have some interaction about the questions raised. And I thought the best thing would be, you can't read it all because the heads are in the way, but this is a recommendation which Paul Arias mentioned, which this Blue Ribbon Task Force has produced. And because it's a Blue Ribbon Task Force, the Blue Ribbon Task Force, and it comes from the US, it's likely to have some influence, as so many of these extremely weighty things do in the end, like the cyber infrastructure projects and so on. So I thought I'd put that up, because no doubt it does represent something of a framework to what we've been discussing. But I wanted to really somebody to raise a question now, which we can all discuss in a group. I think we have quite a lot of framework, quite a lot of detail, but there must be things that people want to take up, but they have a burning wish. Has anybody got a burning question at this point? Otherwise, John will have to think of one.
I've got a question. Can't we just come to some of the presentations, both this morning and this afternoon, actually. And one thing that goes in my mind is a lot of this is about, in the end, it is about culture changes, and it's about changing the way in which people work fundamentally. To what extent could we mandate this? I mean, if otherwise, if we don't, it's not just going to be 10 years, is it? Let's face it, it could be 10, 15, 20 years. Can we not just say, this is how things are now going to be?
So the question is about culture change, and should we just mandate it, otherwise it'll take too long. So anybody want to start on that one? I'm sure that Southampton want to mandate it. They're into mandates.
No, it's the opposite, I think. I mean, particularly from a technology viewpoint, what's quite interesting is that with touch phones, they came out and nobody used them. And the iPhone came out and all of a sudden people started using them because it's very usable. And so I'm actually the opposite, which I think is that we need to build things and create an environment where people come and use what we put on offer. And that's the only way you can succeed. And that's why it takes a long time, because you need to understand what people want. And so actually it's the opposite. I think that I think it's impossible to mandate and force people to do something, unless you tell them, you know, if you don't do this, you're going to lose your job.
Michael's got a comment to make. Well,
we've actually had several years of telling people what to do. The ESRC has had a policy, a requirement on all its funded researchers that they should have data management plans and that they should offer their data for deposit in the UK data archive, I think for about 8 or 10 years now. And all the other research councils have slightly shorter periods than that, but still for several years now, had policies in place which say, in one way or another, thou shalt look after thy data properly and share it with your colleagues. And the compliance rates are pitifully low. So I don't think that mandates on their own are going to work. They may work better at institutional level than they do at national funder level. I suspect they might, but I still don't think you'll get to anything like 100% compliance. I think we need lots of carrots as well as sticks. I think we need both. But I think that policies and incentives need to, I'm saying to someone at lunch, to work with the flow of current researcher practice. That doesn't mean to say that that policies have to be slavishly reflexive of current researcher practice, because it will change and it should change in all kinds of ways, which I think were highlighted by some of the results of the survey work that you were seeing this afternoon. But policy that doesn't start from a basis of understanding what it is that researchers are actually doing and what their attitudes are and what their concerns are will not work, certainly not at the 100% level.
Adam had something to say first.
So a couple of comments. So I think, you know, it's sort of, there's a mandate aspect, but it depends on who's mandating it and what the consequences are that makes a big difference, right? So research funders can mandate data management plans and follow up on the execution of them. What I'm really interested in is the story of the senior researcher at, you know, Harvard, say, whose research proposal of excellent scientific quality is rejected because his data management plan was no good. And I'm also interested in the story of the senior researcher whose project is canceled, right, because he wasn't adequately executing his research data management plan. So the
That has happened. Yeah?
I'm waiting to hear it.
Ah. Right?
I'm waiting to hear it.
That's a bit surprised.
Right? Unless we can tell some of those stories and have them be true, right, people won't take those sort of mandates particularly seriously. I'll tell a little story. I used to work for a company called Schlumberger, and they decided they were going to take safety seriously. It's in the oil and gas business, so that's a good idea. And they had a mandatory seat belt wearing policy on all company travel. And they had it for a couple of years. Compliance was low. There was a car full of senior managers in South America. They observed to leave a site without wearing their seat belts, and they were all fired. And that story made the rounds for a decade. Everybody knew it, and everybody wore their seat belt. Right? That story makes a big difference, and the story of the research funding will make a big difference. Well, I also think that the mandates are typically not really operational, right? I say you must have a policy and you must archive your stuff for 10 years. Well, where, right? It shouldn't be something that people have to think about, right? It should be easy, the service should be there, it should be provisioned at the national level, and it should just be sorted out. And take the example of published articles, okay? The author doesn't have the responsibility of ensuring the published article is archived in some adequate place to make sure it's there in 10, 20, 100 years. You don't have to do it. In fact, the publisher doesn't have to do it either.
They have to pay Portico at the moment because of British Library.
No. So we're talking about print material, right? Talking about print material here.
Oh, I see.
There's an extremely resilient, robust, global infrastructure that has a backbone of those national libraries and those major research libraries that just have the darn things, and they take care of them, and nobody worries about it, right? Well, we worry about it, but the publishers and the authors and the institutes that are the funding agencies, they don't worry about it anymore. That's a solved problem, and I think we can make this sort of research data stuff to a large extent become a solved problem in the same way.
James,
before Adam's comments, we were talking about sticks and carrots. So a mandate is a useful stick if people go through it. It's also a statement of principle, and there are various carrots. And I'd be, likewise, like Adam, I'd be very interested to hear these instructive stories or instructive disasters, as it were. But perhaps I would like to put the emphasis upon something different. I think what's come out of the presentations this afternoon is that, and I tried to make the point at one stage in what I was saying this morning, is about assistance for researchers, the support for researchers that the institution can bring. And that comes out in the BMC article I cited. So I don't know where this fits into the carrot and stick analogy or the sort of how you help the donkey, presumably, which is subject to these carrots and sticks, make its way. But you presumably do it by having a supportive infrastructure that makes the research data management easier.
Well, this is what Kenji said, yeah.
And that's very much what the three projects that presented this afternoon are doing. And they also said an awful lot about training. That was in scope in the call for proposals, but I don't think I realised at the time how important that is and how many of the projects would put the degree of emphasis upon training that they have. And it's key, because it's key to the culture change. Culture won't change without assistance, through training, and without having the technical infrastructure in place to make research data management easier, so that there isn't this huge overhead.
Hella has something to say.
I'm not so sure about the training, because we don't need training to use the iPhone. We don't need training to use Google, and they're still very, very big parts of our lives because they're very easy and they're very intuitive to use. And I don't believe that we can hit all the researchers on a university to train them. I more believe in what you were telling, that, okay, it was so easy for you to go into your repository where you had all your articles and just get out a list. So it made your life easier to use it. And I think that's the key point. Things that makes our life easier and make us more productive, we'll use that, and we'll even train ourselves.
So I think that's...
to go back to Jeffrey's presentation, I think the training comes in when it's the unknown knowns, if you like. I mean, intuitive interfaces help you do what is obvious. But there will always be so many functionalities, so many information or data management behaviours that won't be so intuitive, but will be very productive. And I think that's where the training comes in.
Jim?
Yeah, I was just going to say that the thing with using Kenji's institutional repository at the moment, there's something in it for him. If he uses it, he can get his list of publications out of it. The thing on the data side at the moment, there's no career currency in it. You know, he can go through the process of using it, but then he's not getting anything back for it.
So the incentive for the institutional repository is RAE was, yeah, your RAE submission is based on what's in ePrints. If you haven't put a paper in there, it's not going on the RAE, and if it turns out that we didn't pick you to put you in the RAE, you might want to think about that. So actually, it's an interesting, because that's the ePrints is kind of a carrot and a stick, because it makes my life easier because I can generate the report. But actually, the reason I put those in is at the end of the year when they say, right, we're going to do a dummy ref audit. Yeah. And the way we do it is we generate an ePrints report. Yeah. And that's a big incentive to make sure your ePrints repository entry is up to date.
We started with this added thing. So we will have, Adam, you were going to say something.
So two things. One is a citation helps provide an infrastructure for incentive. Yeah. And that was one of the drivers behind DataCite to make it straightforward to get and track the citations for data. And those citations then, you know, they fit exactly into the Thomson Reuters infrastructure for computing impact. So let's leverage that rather than try to do something different. Let's just make it work for us. And also, I think related to making things easy, another thing that we can do at the institutional level and at other levels is make it hard to do the wrong thing. Give your mule a clear path with some barriers on either side. So you dangle the carrot in front, it moves forward, it's not going to wander off into the field because it's less convenient. You don't have to train it to go down the path, but that will help guide it. And I think
you
have some structure systems like that as well.
Did you see you wave your hand? No?
No.
I have a story about it. One of our very senior researchers said she had to submit a final report to ESRC. And she couldn't submit the report because she had to submit some of the data from her interviews. She doesn't submit the report, she doesn't get the second half of the funding, and it was a £2 million project.
Yeah, she doesn't, yeah.
She chased up that data and got it in. So what's interesting with the research councils, I think ESRC is starting to enforce the mandate, whereas most of the other research councils say you must have this, and they don't enforce it. So it's very much...
I hope they do, because most research councils don't even enforce the deposit of a proper report at the end of their project. I know that because they don't make them available. The reason they don't make them available is they're no good, which is ludicrous to me, because basically, so let's hope they pull themselves together. Maybe some other question. Anybody got another seeing the point is you have, Gordon.
Can I just raise what hesitates to do this? The rights of individuals to hold their data,
yeah,
as opposed to the institutional one. In other words, who holds, quote, copyright on any researcher's data, and where does that come into it? Now, I suspect we could probably continue long into the night on this, but nobody's mentioned it so far.
No.
And maybe that's something that could come subsequently. But
this is a scientist speaking.
Very briefly, what people thought about that. I mean, one way to do it, I forget which university does do it, I think it may be Oxford, is it actually transfers the copyright, let's call it that, to the individual, unless it's going to be used for some commercial purpose.
No, Oxford holds everything in their hands in theory. I've seen the contract. My wife is a... It says that they have one of the most awful contracts I've ever seen for members of staff. Not like the one here. But have you ever seen it?
I'm aware of it. Yeah. But one of the interesting things is in the humanities, people are utterly oblivious to.
I know, so they are. But right.
Well, they just assume that they own whatever they create.
Nobody enforces it. In other words,
maybe someone might if suddenly they realise people are generating millions of pounds from their. Yes. Research on 14th century poetry.
Just to clarify, my understanding of the Oxford thing is that they claim to own the ownership of the data, but choose not to
expose
it unless the commercial exploitation unit instructs them otherwise. Is that?
Yeah,
is
but it's made to code in other ways. For example, if I was writing a novel using a computer maintained by the university computing service, that would belong to them. That's very draconian in my view.
So
I very much doubt that they would.
No, I know, it's very wrong.
Yes, it's a funny contract.
Sorry.
Our legal, when we had this workshop, said in English law you cannot own data.
Yes.
If a significant amount of work has been put into generating a database schema, you can own the schema. Yeah. So it's kind of quite interesting. But I think what was interesting with this debate was that in the debate on open educational resources, because we're throwing money around on open educational resources, who owns your lecture notes? And that actually, this issue of who owns what came up around the discussion of open education resources, which is, it is an interesting question.
Well,
yeah.
I think we need to distinguish between two notions of ownership.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There are the legal positions which are a matter of contracts and of legal rights that individuals may or may not have, and there are the, if you like, the more metaphorical ownership rights which people feel that they have because they have gathered, created, added value to the data, particularly in the broad sense of the data, which they haven't yet published. And I think I think I used in my presentation this morning the notion of intellectual capital. And certainly the work that we've done indicates that people have very strong notions of intellectual capital and ownership in that sense of the stuff that they have collected or generated, and I think that, I mean, that in a sense talking about legal contractual rights needs to be put alongside those more nebulous notions of ownership and rights and custom and practice, which has developed over decades, and we're not going to change them overnight.
Anybody got any comments to make? I wanted to know if anybody here from the repository is it. I think we have people from the repository, do we? No?
I'm responsible for the repository.
Yeah, my view is that the repositories, I mean, after all, we're all looking to a large extent at repositories, aren't we? And, for example, in most universities, my impression is repositories are not just able to handle anything very much in the way of data at the moment. I mean, are you able to handle data?
We have the potential to handle it, but we haven't yet configured to do so.
Yeah.
But it's way just a watch and brief, really. and it comes back to resources, a small institution like mine, I mean, I get very depressed coming to research data conferences because I just feel it over, it's very overwhelming to know what's best to do. But, you know, we have to do something.
Well, Kenji's done.
Kenji. Well, ePrint supports data, so eCrystals is the data centre for the National Crystallography Centre, and that's built on ePrint. So
if I was
it needed some modification, but ePrint is kind of going. It can store. I don't know if it can store arbitrary formats, but it can certainly store lots of different file formats.
So if I was an ordinary person at the University of Southampton, I approached the people who run the repository with a data set, saying, "Look, I've got this data set. My research student has left, and I want to take it off her computer and give it to somebody in order to hold it while they're valuable. I can't hold it. I'm just retiring." What would your say?
That is a good question.
Because it happened. My wife is exactly that situation at the University of Oxford.
Yeah.
Sorry, James.
It's like when you retire and you say, "Here's my office. Yeah. I'm off.
It's really valuable, the data, but she just can't keep it at home. Really.
No, sure. Yeah. So I think.
What would happen?
I think the university would do something with it, but I don't think we've crossed that bridge yet. That's
See, my feeling is that the repository movement has a hell of a long way to go to support all the things we're talking about, yet they are always being mentioned as the place where things are going to be put.
Repositories are end products. They're the libraries, aren't they? So the data's, you know, if you're publishing the data at the end, or whether it's interim data, I suppose that's this whole question of the difference between archive and management.
Does anybody disagree with me on this?
No, just thinking in common that the problem's more resourcing and policy rather than a technical one.
Oh, no, it's not technical. Well, it is a technical one for archiving and preservation, but not for immediate reception for the next 10 years, let's say. I've just been to the nerve, I mean, we hear this all the time, and it hasn't moved at all, really. I mean, repositories, of course, in this country are very busy doing something else.
I think they're moving towards data, but...
No? Anybody? Sorry.
Just addressing your question here. I'm from the University of Edinburgh. We've actually set up a data repository.
Good.
It was initially aimed at orphaned data sets. Data sets primarily associated with publication or whatever. And I just speak to the chap over there, and we have a major problem getting content into the repository. It's a resource issue. I mean, we are lucky to have two data librarians, and it's just we have a lot of contact with researchers who do a lot of outreach, but when actually they come along with a bucket full of data, it would take us, in terms of days, months, or whatever, to actually make sense of it and to actually, if we want to mark up and do any specific metadata, etc., etc. So, I mean, I really don't know how that process is going to change in the short term.
Now, Cambridge have done quite a lot, actually. They went out and sought data. And I believe they managed to ingest quite successfully quite a lot of different types of data, but they don't seem to appear very much at the meetings like this.
I mean, we have been talking
about it. They've got more carbon data.
But they're too busy.
It's easy enough to seek the repository in order to give it some sort of credibility, but which... other instances have done that, but the bona fide sort of research are actually getting the data into such a format, it's a resource issue.
I think this is an interesting case in terms of which problem are you trying to solve? Are you trying to solve the data management problem of a bunch of stuff that I already have, or are you trying to solve the data management problem of data that I am now creating? And so what we're looking at is how do I solve the latter problem of, if I am now creating new data, I have an opportunity to organise it in a better way, which is why the training is very important.
Yeah.
Because if you can get the PhD students to do that, even at a very minimal level, that means that in 5 or 10 years' time, you've got a chance. And they're slightly different problems. There's the bulk ingest of, if I've got all of this data and I need to just tag it and it's just a mess... It's like if I've got a filing cabinet. If I've got a filing cabinet and it's full and I need to organise that, it's a very different problem to if I've got an empty filing cabinet and a whole bunch of dividers and a whole bunch of labels and I can start organising myself. So I see that as two different problems. And I think the one of bulk ingest is a much harder problem and more resource hungry.
Michael first, and then Adam.
I think it's slightly more complicated even than that. I think you have got to be very clear about the problem or the issues that you're trying to address. I mean, there are the kinds of issues to do with supporting researchers in enabling them to look after their data, to manage their data effectively, so that they can reuse it, they can get access to it. That's one set of issues. There's another set of issues to do with making data available to other people, whether that's for what I called in my presentation the scholarly record kind of purpose, and so that others can check and validate your data or not, unvalidated as it were, or whether you are trying to make it available to other people so that it can be amalgamated, integrated, aggregated with other sets of data for reuse for quite other purposes. And then, on top of that, you've got the issue of very long-term preservation, not just for 10 years, but for 50, 100 and more years. Now, I don't think that we have properly thought through the differences between those different purposes and the different kinds of structures and the different kinds of procedures that may be involved in seeking to fulfill those different kinds of purposes. It may be that they have to be dealt with all in one place, or it may be that they're better dealt with by different methods and different institutions.
Adam, you had something.
Yeah, I actually wanted to reference back to what's behind us here, which is the Blue Ribbon Task Force report. So I thought it had several good ideas in it, but one really good idea, and that's to use the language of buying an option. Okay, I thought that was just a really powerful, and I like it better than I've been saying just in time versus just in case for a lot of this curation activities. But I like the notion of buying an option. So let's apply it in this case. I've got a researcher, they're retiring. I want to buy an option to make their data and their work meaningful in the future, okay? Yeah. And I need to, I don't have a lot of money, so I want to do it in an efficient way, as low cost a way possible. So if it's paper stuff, that might actually be just putting it in a nice archival quality box and sticking it on a shelf with a label on it and a little bit of information linking it to the researcher, right? That might be all I can afford to do. We need to be able to do the equivalent with hybrid archives as well as digital archives. It is too expensive to go through and completely explicate everything in there. You know, that's the work of, you know, a handful of postdocs in 30 years, right? We need to leave them something fun to do. So let's leave that for them to unpack, but we have to put it on the shelf that they can find and such that it will still be there in 30 years. That's our minimal responsibility. That's the least we can do to make sure that option is available. And there may be some other sweet spots in the space there. And I know they are because I'm a digital preservation person to some extent these days. So there are other things we can do that go beyond getting it in a box on the shelf that are quite useful, but we shouldn't think that in order to do anything, we have to do everything with respect to data curation.
Simon.
Yeah, I think I'd want to pull those last two comments from Michael and Adam together. I very much liked Michael's sort of four tier, I think, or 4 points. And perhaps we can bring that back to the title of today's conference as well, data as content. So content for whom? Content for whom, at what stage in the research process? Yeah. And I think each of those four levels speaks to certain researchers' activities at various stages in the process, the internal, you know, the management of information to create a hypothesis or to do the work, the sharing with collaborators, and then the publication of data to support the publication, and then the long-term archiving of particularly valuable data sets. I mean, I think that has a degree of coherence, and you can see what content, what role is content and data is forming there. What I'd like to sort of close this comment, or my particular comment at this stage with this, is by remarking that the three projects that spoke this afternoon, that's very much what they've started to do, to understand how better to manage those stages of the researchers' activities, enable better management, buying the option, as Adam says, at this early stage of research, in order then to be able to share the data as content when published and long-time preservation. That's not to say that it's easy or all sorted out, but I mean, I think that's very much where the findings of the project seem to be taking us.
From my point of view, I'm extremely impressed by what you're doing, actually. I hadn't come across it before. I've been in this business for many years. This is really exciting to see it just being in this way. Just, you know, all of you, yeah? John, you were saying something.
Pick up on Michael's scenario there. It still seems to me it has enormous synergy with what I refer to as the information life cycle, as here is the data life cycle. I think it's particularly different, and it's going through that process of the initial creation, which becomes a personal responsibility somehow. Either it's an individual creating that data, or that individual has responsibility over the process that's creating that initial data. And a lot of the thing what we heard about this afternoon is that is really pitched at that level. It's how best to ensure that scholars and others are managing at the personal level data being created and moving it on. Second stage to me is about exploitation of that data once it has been created. And that's again either a matter of the individual who's created it or ensuring through sharing policies that others in the field can both exploit it and or validate it through some kind of publication, or use the small p, maybe a big p as well, some kind of publication program. So you go through the usual exploitation phase of the data as it's being created. The third stage along is archiving, and stuff is archived until it either dies, i.e. it has come to the end of its useful life, and therefore the retention policies kick in and it is done away with, or indeed it carries on ad infinitum if that's the consensus or the view of the community around that data. So I think there is that straightforward life cycle to me, and what we're trying to understand is what are the roles of individuals or groups or corporate governance around data across that life cycle. If you map all that out, you begin to see what people should be doing, what are the gaps at the moment between what we're doing currently, what we should be doing, and how does technology play in all of that as well. I think the one thing, maybe my last word, Anthony, I think we haven't kind of explored as much during the day as I would hope we would have done, that's because Mr. Nature didn't turn up right at the beginning, is, you know, the role of publishers in the commercial sector. How do they have a role in all this life cycle? They clearly, to me, have a role in the exploitation phase. I'm questioning whether they have a role in long-term archiving. Those kind of issues, I think we probably haven't explored as much as we could have done.
Because we're coming up to drinky time, aren't we?
I don't know.
Isn't it 4:30 we're supposed to be?
You're always ready for a drink.
Yes, but what time are we supposed to finish, John?
Probably about 4 minutes' time.
So okay. I was very sorry Matt Day couldn't be here because I happen to have views, and unfortunately Maya Amin, who was here, has had to go before tea time, so he would be able to make some comments on this. Publishers do not know what they're doing at the moment, and they haven't moved quickly enough to define the role of data sets in relation to publications, which they're holding. And this is a big, they just haven't decided whether they're supplementary or part of the article. And this is something which I've been arguing with them as a publisher for many years, but it's still not there. But they're beginning to think now.
But that's where I think the data site project is
that's
really
interesting. That is wonderful. Yeah, I think data site was a revelation to me, I must say. I think it's wonderful. And do we ought to stop now, do you think? Yep. Anybody that pushed, somebody who's been sitting there quietly, awake, and having things coming into their mind. Anybody got anything they want to say?
So how useful is data that's not, so data that's not connected to a research article and hasn't been independently reviewed, is that useful to anyone other than the author? You know, if you haven't got just an article that's been peer reviewed, at least give some credibility to the data, then I think it's quite dangerous to suddenly share this, to give credibility to the data by allowing it to be shared. You can have data coming out that could mislead people and intentionally mislead people. So I think that there needs to be some kind of quality control.
This was something I forgot to mention earlier when appraising these sort of four tiers or however many we've established. This would fall under the mandate of the Research Council, for example. It's an output of the publicly funded research. Maybe it didn't make it into the publication chain. It doesn't support a particular article, but it may or may not be significant data. One could argue that the natural appraisal process of publication ought to establish whether the data is significant and important or not, but I'm sure that there are exceptions. Whether the existence of a small number of exceptions means that it's worthwhile putting the effort in to curate that data in the long term is an open question.
So I mean, clinical trials, excuse me, that may have negative results and don't result in a publication, are the flagship example of data that should be curated and should be shared. So that's I think probably the most powerful example.
My wife actually does some of the systematic reviews for NICE. And actually, when they do a systematic review and they assess all of the trials, they have to statistically unbias the publications because they actually have to try and synthesize how many trials weren't published, because the data's all skewed to drugs that work. Because the journals reject papers on drugs that don't work, or the companies who funded them don't like them published. So there is a process for statistically de-skewing the publication record. Because of that, because that's how NICE makes decisions on whether we get a drug or not. So, but the other thing I was going to say was with data is that you don't always know that the data that you're generating now is not useful. Somebody else might look at it from a different angle, and there could be a huge breakthrough. Yeah. So, it's hard, especially when it's expensive. And if you're talking terabytes of data, petabytes, zettabytes, I think is the next one. It costs money, doesn't it? So it's a return on investment. Do I spend this many thousand curating this data set or this data set? And you kind of want to curate all. It's a bit like, I use an analogy of your house, where you've got your house and you've got your bookshelves, and then you think, my bookshelves are full, so I'll put some things in the loft and I'll put them in the garage, and you think, oh, I've run out of space, I'll go and hire a lockup somewhere, and then say, well, actually, this is quite a valuable book, so I'll go and give this to the library or all that, I'll chuck that out, I'll give it to a charity shop. So it's sort of managing your stuff. And there are different places you can put it, there are different costs if you've got something, and you need to keep it, but you don't need to use it all the time. You might put it in a lockup that's 50 quid a month. If it's very valuable, you put it in the bank and you're willing to pay to have it in a vault to make sure it will be there, and there's an associated cost with that. So your data has different value. Again, probably depending where it is in the life cycle and things. And these are decisions that you need to make, but there's no real framework for it, isn't it? We sort of haven't quite figured out the whole story on it. That's how I sort of simplify things.
three quick points. I think the issue is quite complicated. Mm-hmm. First one is that, as the Blue Ribbon Task Force said, we need to address the issue of selection. Mm-hmm. We cannot keep everything. Certainly we can't keep everything indefinitely. And we are not very good at the moment in terms of criteria for making the decisions as to what should be looked after. Second point is that I think at a policy level, one of the failings of our funders at the moment is that they don't address the issue of selection. Lots of the policies, lots of the requirements, sorry to repeat myself, they're rather of the thou shalt keep thy data. What data? In what format? No very good guidance to researchers on those kinds of issues. The third point is quality control or quality assurance. And I think that there's a failing in the research community here, that they haven't really addressed the issues of how, what is the equivalent of peer review of publications for peer review of data. We haven't got systems in place for addressing that issue, except in a very few specific areas. There's a big agenda there.
This is such an important set of points, and I think we have to stop, don't we? Because we've got drinks waiting for us in the North Cloisters, where we were before. I think we have to move, because otherwise they'll be standing there with a hold of drinks of somebody who. I want to say thank you, panel. Thank you. This conference event seminar is entirely put together by John Akeroyd. Those of us who have hosted UAL have only just been able to back him up in a humble way. But I mean, I'm very grateful for him for asking you all. I'm very grateful for all of you who come, except the one person who didn't. Who will be cut out. Perhaps he was ill, sorry, fair and fair. Thank you all, those of you remaining. It's always good to see a few people who remain with panels. After tea is absolutely fatal in my view, but still, John is the boss. Thank you. See you again next week. Do come to our meeting in June. Look in your packs. Please come, or send somebody. Kenji, I'll come back to you. Okay, well, thank you. Goodbye then. Everybody, go downstairs and have your drinks.
Thank you, Andrew.